Hello, everyone. This is Rev Paul with Miracles One, and welcome to another episode of Insights on A Course in Miracles. Today, we're going to take a look at the judgment of the Holy Spirit, which is found in the text, chapter 12, section 1, and on page 215 of the third edition of A Course in Miracles. So when I checked in with Jesus about this section, he started off right away with the whole point of this section is a reminder that we really do not know who we really are. We've heard this message many times before, and we need to be reminded again and again that we are really not these bodies, that we're something much greater. There's something much greater underneath. And this reading today talks about that same problem in different words, as he often does. So I want to take a look at the first paragraph here. Jesus says, understand that you do not respond to anything directly, but to your interpretation of it. Your interpretation thus becomes the justification for the response. That is why analyzing the motives of others is hazardous to you. If you decide that someone is really trying to attack you or desert you or enslave you, you will respond as if he had actually done so, having made his error real to you. To interpret error is to give it power. And having done this, you will overlook truth. And this piece here really is about projection. When we've sided with the ego thought system and the way that the ego perceives things, we have a tendency to automatically judge and analyze. What are the motives of other people? What are they doing? And because we've done this so quickly and so automatically, the response that comes back to us, that message that we unconsciously, that projected message we've unconsciously sent out to the other individual, comes back to us and becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Okay. And this is all an error, and we've given it power. The whole time that we're doing this, we're totally ignoring the truth. And the truth is inside of that other individual, there is a very holy, spiritual, creative being that was created perfect, sinless, all powerful by God. And so were you. But we ignore this truth because we're not seeing it. We're not experiencing it within the physical world. All right. Let's dig in here a little bit more. Now, he says later in paragraph 3, there is but one interpretation of motivation that makes any sense. And because it is the Holy Spirit's judgment, it requires no effort at all on your part. Every loving thought is true. Everything else is an appeal for healing and help, regardless of the form it takes. So really, it's a reminder to call upon the Holy Spirit within yourself to reinterpret these judgments that we make, to be mindful, to step back and remember that what I'm seeing is not real. And these assumptions and judgments that I make about other people, their behaviors, their actions, it's a problem because it's keeping me distracted from the truth, from finding the truth. All right. And if we call upon the Holy Spirit, if we pause for a moment and say, Holy Spirit, this is what I think I'm perceiving and thinking and judging about this other person. What do you think about it? And if you pause and go within and listen in your own way to the Holy Spirit, you will discover that he will bring a different insight to you. He will bring a different perspective to you. And you also begin to recognize that whatever that individual is doing that you're judging them about, it really is a call for help. It's a call for God, because they have forgotten who they really are. And at the same time, it's also a call for God and a call for help from you, because you're caught up in it because you projected some judgmental thoughts in the first place. So you need the help just as much as the individual does. But with the Holy Spirit's perspective and a reminder, that insight, now something else can come in. A little bit of love, a little bit of compassion, which is why I like the beginning of paragraph 6. Only appreciation is an appropriate response to your brother. Gratitude is due him for both his loving thoughts and his appeal for help. For both are capable of bringing love into your awareness if you perceive them truly. And all your sense of strain comes from your attempts not to do just this. If you perceive them truly, that's the piece where the Holy Spirit helps you out. But I want to back up a little bit more. Gratitude is due him for both his loving thoughts and his appeals for help. So we can easily feel love for another person when we know that they're extending loving thoughts to us, or words or gestures. But when they're appealing to us for help, we may respond with fear. If someone walks up to you and asks you for some money on a street corner, a lot of people, myself included, have responded with fear or with judgment. We think they're going to do something inappropriate with the money, or help them to continue with a bad habit or an addiction or something like that, right? We make judgments, right? And that's when you think about that, and then we can find ourselves maybe avoiding that situation, avoiding that person, or, you know, but underneath all of that is fear. Okay. It's, we only have two emotions that we can respond with. One is fear. The other one is love. Fear is not real, but we believe it's real. We give it power. And so this appeal for help from another individual, depending upon the context of the situation, we can respond with fear and defend, you know, being defensive or try to avoid it, right? Or we can respond with compassion. And compassion is the one we want to remember to do. We may not understand the situation, but if we can respond with compassion, compassion and love are in alignment with each other, and they're in alignment with God. They're in alignment with the truth of who we really are. And now that becomes a gift, not only to that other person, but it becomes a gift to yourself on a very unconscious level, right? Okay, that is how both are capable of bringing love into our awareness if we perceive them truly. So if we can remember to try to have some compassion, say, I do not understand why this person behaves this way. We really don't know what's going on. We haven't walked a mile in their moccasins, in their shoes, to really understand what brought them to that place in their lives, or they need to stand on a street corner and ask you for some money. But if we did, we certainly would feel compassion and perhaps even empathy, some form of love and forgiveness on some level. Now, here's something else that's important to keep in mind, which he mentions later in paragraph 6. Do not attempt to help a brother in your way, for you cannot even help yourself. But hear his call for the help of God, and you will recognize your own need for the Father. And I think this is important to remember, because in the moment when someone asks for help, we need to call upon the Holy Spirit within us for the guidance and the wisdom to have the right response in that moment to be truly helpful to that other individual and to ourselves. Because we really don't know. We might think we know, well, if I give them the money, that's the right thing to do. Not necessarily. Holy Spirit, what would you have me do in this moment right now? What would you have me say? What would you get it? Okay, so it's important to not assume that the opposite is the right answer, okay? Because we can't even help ourselves. All right. And then when we do call upon the Holy Spirit, this whole thing is a recognition of our need for help from the Father, from God, from the Holy Spirit. Okay. And then consider how well the Holy Spirit's interpretation of the motives of others will serve you then. Having taught you to accept only loving thoughts in others and to regard everything else as an appeal for help, he, the Holy Spirit, has taught you that fear itself is an appeal for help. This is what recognizing fear really means. If you do not protect it, he will reinterpret it for you. So if you do find yourself responding with fear or avoiding it, don't huddle and keep that with you and walk off with that and then move on with your day. Don't protect it. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you to look at it, to reinterpret it for you. And he will. He will reinterpret it. That is the ultimate value in learning to perceive attack as a call for love. Because the whole attack process really started with you in the first place. When you made a judgment about another person, that wasn't founded upon love. That was founded upon fear. It's very subtle. It's an automatic habit. It's just the way the ego thought system works. It's the way our culture works. It's the way our brains work. All right. Fear is a call for love in unconscious recognition of what has been denied. And that brings us back full circle. And what has been denied is the truth of who we really are, which we are very holy, creative, spiritual, powerful, sinless beings who were created exactly like God, and there's nothing wrong. We're eternal, we're timeless, we're all loving, we're happy, we're joyful. It's all in there. The whole package is in there, and we got to learn how to let that shine out again, let that come out again. So let us practice that as we continue to move forward in celebrating our Thanksgiving season this year, which is coming up in a few weeks. So that's my invitation to you to remember all of these things and the truth of who you really are, to call upon the Holy Spirit inside of you, to learn this truth so that you can have a full heart of thanksgiving and gratitude this Thanksgiving season. And as we move into this season or this week, if you will, if you want to take a lesson at take a look at lesson 126. All that I give is given to myself in the workbook for students. That lesson would be a wonderful complement to this reading and study that we took a look at this week. Practice that lesson. It's in complete alignment with this reading and how to work through this issue of seeing others different and really our own internal call for help and answering that call for help and answering the call for help for others, and to find that, to discover that truth inside of us. It's exactly what that lesson will do, is help you to discover that and experience it for yourself. So thank you again for joining with me. Thank you for being my mighty companions. I love you all. Have a wonderful day. Take care. We'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.